God gave us one of the most dramatic options when the curtain in the temple was torn from top to bottom, and the curtain is sometimes called the veil. No one ever dreamed such a thing would happen. Matthew, Mark, and Luke all mention it. The moment Jesus died, the veil in the temple was torn. Now keep in mind that God had instructed Moses to build the temple in a certain way, and if you read Exodus 26 sometime, you'll learn what the instructions were and how specific they were. And there God also said, inside the tabernacle, make a curtain from fine linen with blue, purple, and scarlet guardian angels embroidered into the cloth, and hang this curtain on gold hooks set onto four pillars made from acacia wood overlaid with gold. The pillars are to be set in silver bases. Behind this curtain, place the ark containing the stone tablets engraved with God's laws, and the curtain will separate the holy place and the most holy place. And then it goes on to say, to install the mercy place, the golden lid of the ark, the most holy place. And then also said to put where to put the table and the lampstand across the room from each other and on the outer side of the veil. And all those instructions were so specific. So the instructions were specific with regards to the temple, how it's instructed, what the veil is to be like. And then if you look at this picture for a minute, just a picture of the temple. It's rather elaborate, and at the front of the temple there is what's called the beautiful gate, and then there are steps going up into the temple. There is a courtyard, there's a gathering place, there's a specific place for women, outside there's a place for the Gentiles, and then the holy place and the most holy place are located at the back. And that holy place is the one where priests were allowed to enter, and it's the place that they would tend to their daily rituals and make sacrifices. And so priests would enter that area every day to commune with God and tend to the altar of the incense, the lampstand, and the table of the bread. So there's that area where the priests are allowed. And then beyond that, behind the veil, is the Holy of Holies. And that is the place where people believe God dwelt. And only the high priest could enter the Holy of Holies. Even he could do so only once a year on the Day of Atonement to make atonements for the sins of the nation as a whole, to make amends, to make things right with God. And so the high priest would enter, would make a sacrifice representing the sins of all of Israel, because with sin there is a price to pay. The curtain that the high priest went behind reminded him and everyone else that sin separates and keeps us apart from God. And for that to change, a sacrifice must be made. Now, when we think of a curtain, we might imagine something like living room drapes. The curtain or the veil in the temple was nothing like that. It was, as I mentioned, it was made of blue, purple, and scarlet yarn and finely twisted linen with cherubim worked into it by skilled craftsmen. And Jewish writers say that it was 60 feet long, 20 feet wide, thickness 3 or 4 inches, and it would require many, many, many men to put that up. And such a curtain would never be torn by the hands of human beings. In the scriptures, it says that when it was torn, the veil was torn from top to bottom, and only someone with incredible power could do that. Only God could. And that tearing, the tearing of the veil, happened at the precise moment when Jesus breathed his last breath. It happened precisely when Christ died, the moment Jesus cried out from the cross saying, "It's finished," and when he lifted his spirit to God and died, the veil was torn from top to bottom in the temple. And how do we know that actually took place? Well, there were eyewitnesses. It was the day leading to the Passover. It was a great day of preparation. People were bringing their Passover lambs to be slain by the priests. People were everywhere at the temple that day. Priests were there preparing their daily sacrifices. So those who were working on the outer court and those in the holy place before the court, the curtain, doing their required duties, they would have seen the actual tearing of the curtain or the immediate results of it. And all at once, at the moment of Christ's death, that veil that separated a most holy God and sinful humans was torn. In God's perfect timing, witnesses were there that day. And no doubt they sensed that God was doing something new. Until that moment, the veil in the temple declared, "Keep out, do not enter." From that moment on, the torn veil declared, "Whoever will, come." The new thing was new access to God, a way into the holy presence of the living God forever and for everyone. The veil had been a constant daily reminder of sin, penalty of sin that had to be paid, constant reminder that God was not accessible, whereas now no one is kept from the presence of God. And there is no keep out sign, no notice saying no trespassing, nothing saying unauthorized personnel only. Unauthorized personnel forbidden, I should have said. But you know, Jesus opened the way to God. Opened the way to God. No more sacrifices needed. Price for sin was paid. Waited until the holy presence of God is open. And you know, that's a great privilege. That's a great privilege for us as Christians. It is a privilege to be one because we have certain advantages given to us by God. And in Hebrews it says this, we have confidence. We have confidence to enter the most holy place by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way for us through the curtain, that is his body. We have the right to enter God's presence directly. Have you ever wondered what it'd be like to gain an audience with the Queen of England? To enter the fabled halls of Buckingham Palace, to be escorted by the royal guards, to sit in the inner chamber and be greeted by the Queen and have her say, "What can I do for you?" Meeting the Queen would be a privilege, but it's not likely to happen. The Queen is a very important person. We aren't British subjects. We don't have the standing to gain an audience with the Queen of England. The privilege doesn't belong to us, but in the eyes of God, we have standing through the blood of Jesus and by his death on the cross. He's torn down that wall that stood between God and us, and we can go directly to him anytime. When the son of a pastor was about 4 or 5 years old, he wanted to go with his father to a special night of prayer at the church. The format called for the father to begin each hour with a brief greeting to the people who gathered to pray. And at the time, some would leave while others were joining. And after one such turnover, a friend came up and said to him, "Did you notice what Josh did?" "No, what did he do?" "You didn't see it." His friend told him that while he was leading the departure of some and the arrival of others, talking with the people, Josh had come up and said something to his friend. And he'd stopped what he was doing, talked to the boy for a moment. And when they finished, the little boy turned and walked away while his dad turned and continued talking to the crowd. And what his father pondered over afterwards was that he didn't really remember the incident, seemed so inconsequential and natural that Josh should just come up to him at the front and tell his dad something. And even better, Josh didn't weigh up his right to approach his father and draw attention and talk to him by virtue of the fact that he was his son. He just knew. He just knew that he could come to dad anytime. And so it is for every one of us. There's no thick curtain, no veil keeping us away. We can talk anytime to God. Never are our problems, our questions beneath his notice. And never have we done something so terrible that God will never listen to us. We have the privilege of an audience with God himself, anytime, anywhere, and as often as we like. Rank has its privileges. We all know that. Who can deny it? There are those in the world today who have access to the best of everything, things like tickets to sold-out events, first-class travel, VIP lounges, best seats in the finest restaurants, and so on. That's how the world is. We, however, have an all-access pass to the throne room of the universe. We have rights greater than the world reckons to be VIPs. We may get the in, they, others might get inside tips for investing.